So, Joe Streeter for British Boxers TV. My pleasure to be joined by Chad Too Slick Sugden. Chad, firstly, how are you coping with isolation?
It's not ideal, but yeah, I'm coping. It's time to I'm just training and doing what I can at home, really, and little bits. It's handy being able to, because obviously we're in our own gym, so be able to go in and do our own bit, isolate. That's handy, but obviously it's without sparring and stuff like that. It's a bit boring, obviously.
Yeah.
Losing the British title shot, it's one of them things, isn't it?
So, Will, I presume you'll still, that fight will still happen once
Yeah, still on for the fight, but obviously when you're a week away, you're sort of itching to go get in there, do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And you don't strike me as somebody that is ever sort of out of the gym. You know, you don't strike me as somebody that ever stops training. But how difficult was it sort of building up a training camp almost to, I guess, the point of where you were ready, you were sort of tapering down and just making weight?
Yeah.
Because now you've just got to go and tick over sort of thing?
Yeah, it was difficult. I mean, Shekhan's in the same boat as me, and I know there was the MTK tournament the week before, which was cancelled, and I think they was on the way to the weigh-in. So, yeah, it's one of them things where it tests you as a character, and it just gives us time to obviously taper down a little bit and tick over until we get a confirmed date. But at the minute, that's still, I mean, I don't have a clue when that's going to be yet.
Yeah, I mean, something that I've seen. Everybody's in the same boat, so everybody's sort of banding around ideas.
Yeah.
Something that I've seen pitched from a few promoters is to have the fight behind, have, you know, various fights behind closed doors. I know you always bring with you a loud, very vocal fan base. Part of the boxing nights are the atmosphere. Is that something you'd be open to doing, or would you rather wait a little bit longer?
I mean, of course I'd be open to doing it, because obviously I want to fight. While we're in this isolation, it gives me something to focus on and stuff like that. But obviously, I think every boxer would prefer to have a crowd there, especially myself being, I get such a big following, and it wouldn't really be fair on the people. But obviously, being on Channel 5 or wherever it would, I don't know if it would still be on Channel 5 or that, but it would help that people could still watch it at home and give them something to focus on. Because I know me and myself personally, I miss football and missing boxing at the weekends. I know there was meant to be a UFC card on this weekend, but that's just been cancelled as well, because that's supposed to be behind closed doors. But yeah, it's something that I would like to look at doing, because we never know how long we're going to be in this situation. So, and as a boxer, you only get paid when you fight. So it's something that, yeah, I would definitely be up for.
Yeah, and you mentioned the UFC there. One of the things I heard from the UFC was that he's in the process of buying a private island, to host fights on the island. I'm not sure if you've heard about that.
Yeah, I have. Yeah, it's interesting to see how he's going to get around that. Because with all the flights and that not being on, I don't know how he's going to get fighters there and stuff, but it'd be good. It'd be good for the fans. And it would, I think it would take UFC to the next level, really, because they've been able to provide something that no one else is.
Yeah, exactly. There's all these, you know, not just combat sports, but all these just sports fans are just desperate to watch a bit of sports.
Exactly, yeah. Everyone's missing it.
And obviously, you're in the fortunate position where a lot of your training partners are also your family. So,
have you
still managed to maintain some training partners and manage to train with your brothers? And
yeah, that's it. I mean, obviously, my dad's my coach, and my brother Bailey and Regis, we all live under the same household. So, it's handy to have them around and keep taking over, do you know what I mean? I've had to take a couple of days out here and there and focus on other stuff, because you can't keep the same intensity up, as that's what we have training camps for, do you know what I mean? To peak for that fight. But obviously, for me, I'm just focused on keeping my fitness levels up, keeping my weight on track, and just developing new skills.
Yeah, I guess obviously you took the Craig Richards fight at very short notice. You stepped up to take this one, although you were already on the undercard. You stepped up at, I guess, sort of short notice. At least now, if we're clutching at silver linings, I guess you'll have a little bit of time to prepare, and we'll really see the best Chad Sugden.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it definitely does help. I mean, we was training for Shekhan anyway, because we knew one of them could pull out. They're both taller than me, so it was an easy one to train for. And before we even got the Shekhan fight announced, we'd already had the sparring lined up with Jose Burton, who's obviously, he's 6'4" and he's tall, rangy, light heavyweight, and he's former British champion. So I don't believe it could have got better sparring than that.
That is perfect sparring for that fight, really, isn't it?
Yeah. So I was, that was already lined up, and we got a good 30 rounds with him in. Before this one, and other sparring partners as well. So yeah, it's Jonathan, just look forward to when it gets reset up, and I can't wait to get in there and showcase my skills and what I've been working on.
Yeah, that was, you know, my next question. Just how excited are you for when that does?
Yeah, I'm so excited. I can't wait for it. It's always been a dream of mine to win a British title, and for it to come round, if I look at myself this time last year, I was only somewhere in the rankings on BoxRec. So to be where I am now, and I think it's taking the opportunities when I've got them, got given them, and I've done well in them fights as well. So now it's my time to do it on a proper fight camp, proper time to prepare. I believe you'll see something that you haven't seen in me before, and also you'll see the best version of me. It's exciting, and I'm excited for it.
Yeah, I mean, there'll be people that, you know, there'll be boxing fans that the only time they saw you was in the fight against Craig Richards, which was obviously a bit of a tear up.
Yeah,
your nickname is Too Slick. And you've been fighting since you were a kid. You've got this incredible movement as well. I bet you're looking forward to showcasing the other side of your game, if you like.
Oh, of course. That is my main part of my game, and I think people underestimate my boxing skills because of my height. But it means nothing. And when I get in there, I'm looking forward to showcasing that. I mean, my nose broke in the second round of the Richards fight. It was already. It had already been broke before in training camp. So it did sort of affect my vision, and obviously I had to sort of take it to war sort of thing and see where I could go with it. But that's where I can go. I can sort of do everything, really. I've had that many fights in amateur boxing, kickboxing, and now professional boxing. I've had to go to all different places and dig deep when I need to, and box when I need to, and it's one of them things where, yeah, I'm willing to go where the fight's willing to take me, and I'm going to train as if it's the hardest fight of my life, and then anything less than that is a bonus.
Yeah, and obviously the movement that you have, the slickness that you have, is something that. You know, predominantly we associate more with boxing on the back foot, and you know, Floyd Mayweather in the later stages of his career style. Obviously Shakhan Pitts is much taller than you, and you like to come forward. How valuable is that? How much of an underrated tool is that movement as you attack, as you come forward, as a come forward fighter?
I think people will be surprised when I'm in there, when I'm landing jabs and stuff like that and beating into it sometimes, because that's one of my skills is the range, being able to stay relaxed in that firing range and work from there, not be uncomfortable. I've obviously dealt with all different shapes and sizes of people in, and I've had knees thrown at me and kicks thrown at me as well. So although I know Shakhan's a good boxer and I've seen him, but I don't believe he's got anything that I haven't seen before. So I know I've got to get to him, and I know I've probably got to put the pressure on and get inside, because obviously I'm not going to be able to let him stay at range all night, because I mean, how are you in a fight? So, but I will be in there to rough him up and get to him.
Yeah, and you mentioned before about having travelled all over the world and fought everywhere.
Yeah.
How much do you take from that? You know, you see a lot of fighters, they don't even really get out of their hometown. How much do you take from sort of embracing fight cultures and going all over the world and fighting in different styles?
Yeah, it's you do see different ways of doing stuff, and I think you've got to look at it and take it or leave it sort of thing. But I think it's always good to keep your mind open to how people do things, because some things will work for you, but a lot of it won't.
Yeah.
But it's about finding the stuff that does, and unless you try out some of the things, you won't know. So I always look at it as in, I've been in worse places than this. I've had a lot more against me in fights abroad, when I've been away from home. I've been in the away corner and come out on top. So if I can do it in these foreign countries where it is all against me, then why can't I do it down the road in Coventry? On the biggest stage, really, on Channel 5, where there's going to be a lot of people tuning in to watch, and it's for the legendary Lonsdale belt.
Yeah, well, where will that, you know, if you win the Lonsdale belt, where will that rank? You've got this incredible history, especially given your age in combat sport. Where will the Lonsdale belt rank, do you think?
Yeah, it's the biggest. It'll be the biggest achievement. Obviously, I'm the youngest ever ISK kickboxing world champion and second in glory, but this will be on par with that, the British title. But before I get too excited, obviously I need to get in there and do it. But yeah. I also I want to defend it 3 times, so I get to keep the belt as well, because it's a nice belt, and I believe other than some of the world titles, it's the nicest belt in the game.
Yeah, I can't disagree with you on that. And you look at some of the best fights have been for the Lonsdale belt, which I guess just how much it means, right?
Exactly. I mean, for me, anyone that wins the Lonsdale belt, most people that win the British title are the fighters have gone on to fight for world titles, if not winning them. I believe it's a very prestigious belt, and I'm looking forward to it. It's all the best fight for it, and I'm looking forward to getting in there and getting to fight for the legendary belt. And if I can put myself up there with some of them names, then that's the biggest achievement yet.
Yeah.
But I believe I've got the skills to do it, and I will do it on the night. And I believe I can go on to bigger and better things as well.
Yeah, well, against Luke Blackledge, he had a lot more experience than you. He obviously had a winning record against Craig Richards. I'm sure you won't mind me saying, but you were very much there as the away fighter on a week's notice.
Yeah.
You've sort of got a knack for rising to the occasion, and I guess that's something that you plan on doing again.
Yeah, for sure. And this time, I believe I'm having a more dominant performance. I think a lot of people, although they underestimated me before the fight with Craig Richards, and there's a lot of people not expecting me to do too well, apart from the people that knew me. I also think a lot of people underestimate Craig Richards and what he's done. They all go looking back on when he lost to Buglione, which was a fight that he only took on a week or two's notice. And I think if you look at what he's done now to other people, he's a dangerous fighter and a good fighter. And him and Shekhan was a 50-50 fight. But I believe on if I had 5 or 6 weeks or even 8, or what I'm going to get now is a full camp's notice, then I can beat Craig Richards tomorrow. Do you know what I mean? So I also believe I can beat Shekhan. So it's a fight I'm looking forward to. And I know Shekhan's good, but he hasn't been tested by someone like me or like Richards yet. And this is, for me, is as much a test for me as it is for him. So I'm excited and I'm fully prepared. I'm going to be fully prepared for it.
And how much do you think in the Richards fight? Not that the early rounds weren't going your way, but I felt like you grew into the fight. Sort of sussed him out a bit more and sort of stopped it. He was landing a lot of the jab in the earlier rounds, and then you sort of halted that a little bit.
Yeah.
How much can you benefit from, especially with like fighting such a taller guy like Pitters is sort of is figuring out a puzzle, right? Trying to get in there. How much can you benefit from it being a longer fight?
Of course, and the longer rounds have always suited me. If I have a spar or anything like that, the second time I go up, I'm always better. And I'm one of them fighters that does work people out, but I'm very hard to work out myself. And I believe Shekhan's going to be one of them. I believe early on he's going to be awkward because anyone at 6'6" who can move and throw long shots out, they're going to be awkward. But there will be a top time when I start slowing him down, and that's when it's going to hit the fan for him, and mentally it's going to be hard for him.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to that, and like I get better as fights go on, so that's one of my assets. And I believe if I start well, then yeah, it could be early night, to be honest.
Something you've talked about a little is the range, and you've got this good judge of range. You'll beat taller fighters to the jab and stuff like that. How much of that do you think comes from your background in dealing with roundhouse kicks and knees and stuff like that?
I suppose it's a lot, really, and obviously because of the kickboxing and the boxing, I've always sparred. I've been sparring all over the world as well as fighting. So I'm always working with different shapes and sizes and heavier people, lighter people, taller people, smaller. You learn how to deal with all sorts. And one of my things is I've got a few heavyweight sparring partners and other sparring partners who they're always shocked at my presence when I'm in the ring. Obviously, when I'm standing next to Shekhan, everyone can see their height difference and the mass. But I believe when we're in the ring, it's not going to look that big. He has his feet very wide, which is going to make him struggle to move quickly, and also rotate enough on his hips to get the power. So I believe I'm going to work inside of him, but also, I believe the kickboxing and stuff like that has helped me deal with range in the past. And like his arms are long, but they're not as long as some of my opponent's legs have been. So it's good. I look forward to testing my skills against, I believe, the other best in Britain other than the guys that are on world title level.
Yeah. And are you obviously a student of the game, a student of combat sports and boxing. Got the you've got the portfolio of great fighters tattooed on your arm. Am I correct in thinking Marvin Hagler is one?
Yeah,
obviously Marvin somebody you can take inspiration from. I think it's the anniversary of his fight with Tommy Hearns today.
Yeah, I've seen it on Facebook earlier. What a fight that was as well.
Incredible fight, and similarities in terms of styles.
Yeah, I would say so, very much so as well. And he actually said he aspires to be like Tommy Hearns, and I thought that's interesting. I've got Marvin Hagler and Sugar Ray on my arm. It's one of them things. And like they said, I think someone said that if Tommy Hearns had the balance of Sugar Ray, and he could have beat them all. But it's a hard thing. The thing is with being that tall and that, you've got to lack in other areas, in my opinion. Or there's going to be something I can open them up with, and but I'm looking forward to it. If it's anything like the Hagler-Hearns fight, then yeah. The fans are definitely going to be the winners on that night.
Definitely. And who else do you have tattooed on your arm? What would be the thought behind getting, you know, them specific fighters?
So obviously Hagler and Leonard, they are greats, and I've always watched the fights back. As a kid growing up, like, my dad was big fans. Yeah. Also Ali, I think Ali, for anyone, is the greatest, including personality and stuff like that, and what he's done for the sport of boxing and just the world in, like, what he did for equal rights and, like,
his character
is unbelievable, mate. Like, when I've watched a new documentary on him not long back, which was out on Sky, which I think What's My Name it's called, and it was unbelievable. Like, I've seen a few bits that I haven't actually seen before. And then I've got Floyd Mayweather, Mike Tyson, and Manny Pacquiao. A few ones that I've seen as I was a kid and growing up, who, in my opinion, Floyd and Manny, they're the best of this sort of era that's just been.
Yeah.
Obviously, you've got people like Lomachenko now coming through and Alvarez. But, yeah, Floyd and Manny for what they've done as well. Probably the only one that I ain't got on there that I also think was a bit of a great was Joe Calzaghe. But obviously, the ones that I've got on my arm are the ones that, yeah, really inspired me to, I don't know, inspire my style and who I watch and want to be like.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, you take bits from each guy and you sort of sprinkle them into your own style, if you like.
Yeah, that's it. I think it's hard. You don't want to be like a jack of all trades, but if you can be great in so many different areas, then you can change the fight to how you want it to be, sort of thing. And I'd be a one trick pony because them sort of people can get figured out. And I think when you get to the higher level, which is where I'm at now in the 12 rounds, this is where all my training and different styles of training and stuff is going to pay off the most, because in a 12 round fight, the fight can change back and forth all the time, and this is where you find out who the real Chael Sugden is.
And obviously it's interesting that you know your mix of fighters that you sort of idolise. We're both of a similar age, and the fighters you idolise sort of transcend generations, if you like. So I really resonate with what you're saying, because it's the same fighters that, you know, obviously I know your dad is into boxing, you know, the same fighters my dad showed me, and then I built off. And the Joe Calzaghe Jeff Lacy fight was one that made me sort
incredible.
Of fall back in love with boxing. And
yeah, for me, Joe Calzaghe is, to be fair, I can't believe I haven't watched it before. I watched Mr. Calzaghe, you know, it's on Amazon Prime, and like, you look at the fights he had, I think it was about 8 years where he didn't spar for any of his fights, and there was world title defences, and people were like, oh, why is he's just scraping through these fights, but he won like a couple of his fights between the fight and the next fight, he didn't actually hit a sparring partner. And you just think, that's incredible. And then until he got his hands sorted, he did a bit of sparring for Jeff Lacy, but he was still injured. And look what he did in that fight.
Yeah, I think I read somewhere that he was really close to pulling out of that fight because of his hands.
Yeah.
And his dad said, you just can't, if it'll never come around again, this fight.
Yeah,
and then somebody defeat him with one hand.
Exactly, and he was like, he said, "Look, you can beat him with one hand, but if you don't, I'll be still proud of you. But you can't pull out because this is the fight." Yeah, and he went in there and did the job. And I think as long as you can get the fitness up and the sharpness somehow without sparring. You can do it, but it's hard. So sparring is what makes the training real.
Yeah.
And if you have a hard spar, then you know next week when you do that run, you need to run a bit harder. Do you know what I mean? The sparring relates to the actual fight. So it must have been hard for him to do that and without sparring. But I suppose he must know he had that many fights by then. He knew where he was at, sort of thing. He's an incredible fighter. Incredible.
Yeah, so obviously you said there that you sparred Hosea Burton for did a good 30 rounds with Hosea.
Yeah.
You really preach the importance of sparring, and I can't disagree. Somebody else that in your division actually that refrains from sparring or says he refrains from sparring is Tunde and Anthony Yard. I don't know if you keep abreast of that story, but what do you make of that?
Honestly, everyone to their own and stuff like that, but I don't believe you can gain the sharpness without the sparring. Obviously, he has done really well, Yard, and done all these fights, but for me, the fight with Kovalev, I think with sparring, he could have won that fight. Look how close he was to winning.
Yeah.
You think it could have made the difference? How do you know that wasn't the thing that made the difference?
And, yeah.
For him to go out in that eighth round and literally throw the tank away, I don't think it was his fault because he got told to do that. But that's saying if you don't get him out this round, then you're done. Do you know what I mean? And I think you need sparring to keep yourself sharp, to keep yourself humble, because if you're not getting hit in the gym and you're making mistakes on the bags and stuff like that, how do you know that you're going to get hit? Do you know what I mean? I don't really get it. I know Tunde does a lot of aggressive pads when he hits him and stuff like that, but you need someone hungry that's coming to try and take you out.
Yeah, you can't replicate having a Hosea Burton stood in front of you trying to.
I think Yard is a great fighter, to be honest, considering he doesn't do much sparring, because his timing, that seems all right. But does he get put under the cosh in the gym? Because sometimes sparring, when you've got two or three sparring partners, and it can be the randomest of people that make you feel that pressure. And before the Kovalev fight, was he getting that in the gym? Because how else do you get it?
Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, you need to have the first time you're in the trenches, if you like. You don't want that to be in the ring on the night. You want
on the
know
big
you,
stage. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. You want to know you've been to the trenches before, right?
That's it. And I don't believe you have the fights that have put him there. Like, who can name his opponents before that fight? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The no names that, I mean, some of them are our opponents, I suppose, but the no one that you go, oh, wow, he beat him.
There were no fights you weren't expecting him to.
Exactly. And he's never had to dig deep. So what was they expecting when he had to in that fight with Kovalev? It was always going to be hard. And for me, he looked tired. And if he's never been that in training, that must have been horrible for him to feel that against a world-class operator like Kovalev, who is, in my opinion, past his best, but still a world-class operator. Do you know what I mean? He's for me, I thought Yard could have took him. It'd be interesting, his fight with Lyndon Arthur. It's nice to see a Brit fighting a Brit, to be honest. But obviously, and I think Lyndon's a good fighter, but I believe Yard will be too much. Just because I believe they're very similar fighters, and I think Yard's a bit bigger and a bit more heavy-handed, and the confidence will show.
Yeah, it will be interesting. I'm sure. I'm pretty sure it's not going to be an easy fight for either guy.
No.
It'll be interesting to see if Lyndon can make Anthony Yard dig deep and make it take him to the deep end, if you like, because as you say, we've not really seen him there yet, apart from Kovalev fight, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. And I've seen Lyndon. He's a good boxer. He picks his shots well, but so does Yard. So for me, it's who stamps the authority on the fight first. And I believe with his Yard's experience now at that level, I think he will. But it'd be interesting to see if Lyndon can dig deep as well. And if he can, then it will get really interesting for Yard, because he'll have to do himself. So it'd be good. I'm really looking forward to that fight. Obviously, it's a fight I'm looking at because you never know. Like, Lyndon's below me in the rankings, and Yard's obviously well above me at the minute. So, but if I beat Shakan and whoever wins that fight, that could be a fight in the future as well.
Most definitely. I think that's for the Commonwealth, and yours is for the British. So it makes perfect sense for a winner versus winner situation there.
It does, yeah, exactly. To the promotion agreements.
Yeah. And how do you think you match up with both of them guys, really?
Yeah, it's their fights that I'll definitely fancy. There's fights that at times you want to make sure your craft is bang on. But I believe now, after the Richards fight and the three fights I had last year and the Shakan fight, I'll be ready for anybody. And yeah, I'd love to fight either of them. I think my boxing skills would be too much for both. But they are good fighters. I rate them both. I rate Lyndon and I rate Anthony Yard. So, and I think that the style with me versus them two will be interesting. But they'll have to dig deep that night.
Yeah, definitely. And just a level above that is like Callum Johnson and Josh Buatsi, also in the division. I guess you keep half an eye on them as well. You keep them in the corner of your eye.
Yeah, of course. I mean, Callum Johnson not far from Boston, and he works with my nutritionist Scott Robinson as well. I believe he's probably the most underrated out of the lot.
Yeah.
Because I think he's the best one to do that fight with that was an incredible fight, do you know what I mean? And for him to put him down and come back and stuff like that, I think Johnson's a very good fighter. And Boatsy is nasty, he's strong, very, very crude on the inside, good of his dirty boxing, and he has some power as well, which you can't deny. The way he finishes people, he's like a shark. He loves to hurt people and get them out of there. But they're both great fights I'd love to do as well.
Yeah.
At some point, obviously, they're at that level, a bit higher. But by the time I get there, I mean, I'm the youngest out of the lot. I'm only 25, so I'm 26 this month, and I'm getting stronger every camp. And I think that's the key, is flowing from one camp and make sure you're gaining on that, because then when I do get there, I'm going to be ready for war, as if to say, and look, I will take any of them fights after this one, do you know what I mean? And,
yeah.
They're great fights to raise my profile.
Well, once you get that Lonsdale strap, that is really, you know, that's not the stepping stone, but that gives you an almost a target on the back that makes you more of an alluring opponent. Right now, you're a high risk opponent that doesn't have that strap, but once you've got that,
exactly, and it'll definitely help me out. Like, at the minute, I think obviously I've got that one loss on my record, so I think that's helped me get the fights. But if you look at me then and me now, it's a different person. And I also believe if I get the British title, there'll be a few people that are up for challenging for it, and I hope I can have three good defence of it and make good fights, build my following. So then when I do go, then I don't know, even to America or abroad or one of these big Boatsy fights or whatever, and for a bigger title, then I want the following, and people want to tune in.
Yeah, and something else I wanted to ask you is you built quite a name, you've built quite a resume within K1 and within kickboxing. How did you always know that you wanted to go into boxing?
Yeah, it was always on the cards because I amateur boxed when I was younger as well.
Okay.
And I always watched boxing. It was always going to happen. I mean, when I was 17, I got my amateur card kick off because I had a kickboxing fight with a head guard, which they assumed was professional, but it wasn't. And then from then, I thought, well, I'm not really ready to turn pro at 17. I didn't know what weight I was going to sit around and stuff like that. So I turned pro kickboxing I took a tournament, an 8-man tournament, which had all the best fighters in the UK, and I'd only had 3 fights at the time, and I'd won 3 and had 2 knockouts, and then I went in this 8-man tournament. No one expected me to win, and I won it, and like that sort of set me up for the international stage.
Yeah.
And I managed to get a few more fights in, and then got signed to a company called K1, which was big, and then it sort of all made sense to stay in kickboxing for a while I was fighting all around the world and getting experience against most of the pro kickboxers that I fight as well abroad. They've also got boxing licenses, like okay. Nicky Elskin was the same division as me, who fought Callum Smith in the World Boxing Super Series. He was the champion and I was number 2 contender, but when I actually stopped kickboxing, and some of them guys have done fights for, I mean, Metal Greenout, who I beat in my last fight in Vegas, he's been the glory champion since, and when he was in K1, he won the $1 million tournament, so it was like a 16-man tournament, and he won $1 million in Japan. Jeez. So I'm fighting with them guys, and
yeah,
that sort of experience, I think, has helped me, and when it gets hard in the fight, and I look across and I think, well, he's only got a pair of gloves on and he can't kick or knee me, and do you know what I mean? And
yeah,
it's a bit different. And I've been there and I've had hard fights, so it just all falls into place for me, and I'm enjoying it at the minute. It's now I'm starting to get the recognition and the fights that get you excited, and that's what's making me even better fighter.
How difficult was it going from, you know, where you're an established in K1, you know, every fight you have is, you know, everybody wants to watch, and this is a big fight now, and it makes you a little bit, you know, makes you a bit scared, if you like. It makes you feel nervous because you know the guy opposite you is a killer, right? He's a top level guy. To go in, to almost going back to square one, to boxing, and boxing people who they're not really a threat to you.
And yeah, I mean, to be honest, obviously, like at first it's a bit of a, I don't know, it was all right. It was like, give me a chance to learn my craft, but then I didn't realise how long that stage is going to last.
Yeah,
and you realise how big the boxing world is then, and how much you have to put yourself out there and take risky fights to make it. Which, obviously, I was lucky. I did sell tickets. I do sell tickets, because otherwise I'd have gone back to kickboxing, I think, because you got no chance if you don't, unless you go away from home. But then you're never going to get the fights unless you've got something to offer. So it's one of them things which is, it was hard, but then now I'm getting, like, after Luke Blackley's fight, and then I got another fight with that Farouk Dekker, who was higher in the world rankings, and then obviously got the last minute Craig Richards fight. Like, it's all changed. It's all gone up pretty quick, and now I don't have to, and now I've got the opportunity now. This could change my life forever, this next fight. So for me to not take it seriously and not put everything in, and go out and win it, then I'd be daft. So it's sort of all come at once, and I'm looking forward to it. Like I was saying to someone the other day, this time last year, I was looking at fighting for a Midlands title. And now I'm looking at the British.
Yeah, it's crazy. And it must be nice to be at that stage of your boxing career now. And you're still young as well. To be like, where you're, you know, fighting big fights.
Yeah, it's amazing. And these are the fights I want. These are the fights you get up for. And I want to go and then see what happens after that.
Yeah. And something else I wanted to mention to you was your amateur kickboxing record. I had to read it 3 or 4 times to believe it. Was it like 100 wins and 5 defeats or something?
Yeah. It's a pretty good record. And
it's
everyone,
incredible.
Yeah, everyone that I lost to as well, I ended up beating. So it was good.
How old were you if you were in that period?
From around 9 or 10 to 17.
Okay.
So, just fighting all the time, really, and in different countries. Did a lot of fights. So a lot of the fights as well were like away from home. So I think when I was 12, I went to Scotland, and a little town in Scotland, to fight their guy who'd never been beat in his hometown. And he was 2 years older than me, and didn't end up fighting until half 12 at midnight.
Wow.
And got booed into the ring and stuff like that. But I was coming away with a win, so I don't know why I got it on the judges' scorecard, because it didn't look like it was going to go my way. It all went pear-shaped in the ring. But like these sort of fights, I was actually against Scott Allen, who's fought for the British title. He's from Scotland. I don't know if you know him.
Yeah.
That was actually against him. I've also fought Carl Williams as well, who's fought for the British title as a kickboxer, and I beat him. But he's another one who's doing really well now. It's good. I mean, them fights made me who I am now, and I'm looking forward to hopefully doing as much as I can in the boxing world. And I mean, I've got plenty of time, and I'm at good weight, like every week. They don't come into the prime till about 30. So, I mean, if I get, I believe I can beat anyone now. So by the time I'm 30, I should be able to beat everyone.
Yeah, and yeah, it's crazy when you know your resume and your age is unbelievable, really. But considering everything that you've done, to be so young is incredibly exciting.
Yeah, it is.
Somewhere else that you fought that I wanted to mention to you, and I see a lot of not so much boxers, but I see a lot of MMA fighters doing training camps there, is Thailand. You fought in Thailand, is that right?
Yeah, I fought in Thailand a few times and been out training there as well.
I've been training there too. Is that for kickboxing or for boxing?
Yeah, that's kickboxing, yeah, because obviously it's just good to get the Thai style. I went out there when I was a junior, about 12, 13, fought in a tournament out there, kickboxing, and did some Thai training as well when I was out there to learn the clinch. And their way of kicking is slightly different to like the Dutch style. So it's always good to learn that, to be able to deal with that, because you do have to fight a lot of Thai fighters in the K1 scene.
And in terms of discipline as well, how does that compare to what you see with sort of European fighters?
It's hard because the European fighters that are really disciplined do really well, but the Dutch way, I mean, they fight 3 minutes, and there's a lot of stories about the Dutch fighters in the past. They go out drinking every weekend and stuff like that, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in fight camp, and they just train and fight and stuff like that. And I suppose it might work for them, but obviously in Thailand, it's a very poor country. So they fight for money from kids. And when the difference out there is when you're sparring and stuff like that, it's all place sparring. Because a lot of them fight every weekend. So that's why you see the records of like 300 fights and stuff like that. So Yeah, so it's good though. It's Thailand's one of them places if you've never been, and I recommend because the people are lovely, the food's good, and I mean the beaches and seas are amazing. I mean some of it's rough. If you go to Pattaya and Bangkok, certain areas, but a lot of the islands and that are beautiful, and it's a great place to train because yeah. There are a lot of different training kind of packages and stuff on that as well. So,
Even in terms of just boxing, would you be open to in the future ever going back there, and or is it
I
not
mean,
so
I'd
much?
have to take my dad and stuff like that with me because the boxing in their speciality. Do you know what I mean? So
Yeah.
when I've been to gyms before, even as a kickboxer, I would always outbox all the Thais, but obviously in the clinch and with the kicks, they were try and beat me. But obviously, I was them as well. But yeah, the hands thing is they're probably not the best at. You could go out there, say like after a fight and in between camps, it'd be good to go out there, stay fit, do a little bit before you come back to train.
Yeah, and then mix it with the beaches as well would be a
Yeah,
good.
that's it. Because you want to like, I don't know if you get the right sparring, especially throwing out heavyweight, just because. The Thais are a lot smaller. And generally, the ones about my weight, they're normally a bit fat. Do you know what I mean? And there's some big ones, like you got Tsingkai, he fights at 75. And when I was in the Fairtex gym up there, he was training, and you wouldn't want to take a kick off him. But then there's like a lot of them are better at the smaller weight. So I suppose if you're a smaller sort of fighter, you could get some decent sparring out there. And I would be able to get sparring because you get a lot of Eastern Europeans that go out there and train. But I wouldn't say it would be perfect for boxing. Not for a fight camp anyway, because you're not going to get the same quality of boxers.
Yeah. But in terms of now, you've having had that in your past, you I guess you benefit from having embraced all them disciplines and
Oh,
embraced all them
yeah.
cultures.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yeah, it's just going, like, obviously, did a lot of training in Holland as well. That was good. Yeah, and just getting up, doing all them different fight camps, and it's all helped me. Definitely,
Yeah,
definitely.
you take what you some things won't you know some things won't stick, but you take what you can from each one and what fits you.
Yeah, that's it. And, like, some stuff you just got to get because it don't work for your certain style or just doesn't work for you in some ways, but then for someone else in the gym or it does work. So it's good for my coaching as well, and I believe that my coaching helps me fight because I learn how to say stuff that I would find easily some people struggle with, and then I learn different ways around it. So if I ever have that problem in a fight, I can then think, right, how can I change what I'm doing to make it work? And having that coaching experience as well, I think helps me do that.
Yeah, you've seen the game from both perspectives, if you like, where you.
Yeah, exactly. And like, I have that frustration of being a coach as well as a fighter.
Yeah.
So I see it when fighters don't do what you want. So as a fighter, I'm a good student because I know what I just give it my all 100%. And if I can do that, then when I get at the end of the fight, no matter what the result, I can be proud of my performance.
Yeah, and you're obviously a student of the game. You mentioned before some of the fight documentaries you've been watching. Obviously, fight fans stuck in quarantine at the moment, no live fights on. Any recommendations?
Yeah, definitely. The Mr. Calzaghe one's really good. I was watching. I've recommended it to a few people and they've loved it so far. There's one on McGregor on Netflix, on Amazon as well at the minute. That's good. And there's also one on, it's called What's My Name, but on Sky Atlantic.
On
This
Ali.
Ali one.
Okay.
Yeah, it's incredible. It's worth watching. I think it's two parts and there's about an hour and something in each one. They're really good. There's a few more that I'm going to watch, but I don't want to recommend them just yet. But there's also the Roberta Duran film on Sky. It's called Hands of Stone. That's pretty good.
So, yeah, is that the film or the documentary?
The film, but I've seen documentary as well.
Yeah. I like the documentary. The film was pretty good as well. It's pretty.
Yeah, the documentary is cool. The film's more fun. Like, obviously you got Sugar Ray in it and that, and it does relay the story. Obviously elaborates a lot of it a little bit, but
it was weird to see Usher playing Sugar Ray Leonard. I was a bit taken aback by that.
Because he got the part of Ali as well, didn't he?
Oh yeah, he did. That's right. Yeah.
It's good, and there's some good stuff to watch out there, and some good fights as well.
Yeah. Any old fight we mentioned the Hagler Hearn fight. Any other old fights that you?
Castillo and Corrales, obviously Ward and Gatti is a good fight. I was watching some Froch fights the other day as well. It was on Sky, yeah. Deadman, one after the other, and obviously the Jermaine Taylor fight. What a fight that was!
It goes, it flies under the radar, that fight a little bit, but incredible, isn't it? And the finish especially.
Yeah, that's it. And you look at some of his finish on Lucien Boutte as well. He's had some. There's some good fights on there, which I enjoyed watching. And then, I watched, obviously, on the Carl Zegger documentary, there's some, the Bernard Hopkins fight was good. That went back and forth. It's a hard fight to watch because there's a lot of mind games and quite, obviously, Hopkins is a very negative boxer, so it makes for a, can be a frustrating sometimes, but it's good to see how Carl Zegger adapts in that fight.
Yeah. Well, I remember, I think we're about the same age, but I'm trying to think how old I was at the time, and I think I was about 14 maybe. And Carl Zegger had just beaten Jeff Lacy, and in my eyes, he was invincible. He was the king of the world. And when Hopkins floored him with a right hand, I was worried. I was scared. I was watching it from behind the sofa.
He looked big in that fight, Hopkins, as well. Massive. To Carl Zegger. I think, although Carl Zegger was quite tall for Super Middle, he was never big. Whereas if you look at him now, he looks like he's filled out a bit, and he's a lot bigger. But I suppose that's why he's so fast and so naturally powerful. He never really needed to get that big.
Exactly. Even if you look in the Lacy fight, it was bigger than Lacy in terms of height, but Lacy was obviously...
Oh yeah,
still far bigger, yeah.
But yeah, some of them fights, I think they're incredible. Jack Neen fights you can't not watch.
Yeah, they are. Every time they come on, and like you say with the Froch fight, every time it comes on, you have to put it on and enjoy it again, like it was just happening now. And yeah, one more just to round off. Back to the fight. But when it does happen, is John Pegg said when Craig Richards pulled out and you stepped up, he said, this is actually, in terms of style, this is actually a better fight. Mm-hmm. How good is this fight going to be?
Oh, it's going to be great. I mean, Shekhan's coming expecting to win. I'm coming expecting to win. We're both training to win. I think you can't beat it. It's a fight not to be missed. And I'm going to come in there and give him a whole lot of trouble, and if he's ready for that, then it's going to be an exciting 12 rounds.
Yeah, stylistically as well, I think really intriguing and also exciting.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it's a fight that's going to shock a few people. I think they're going to enjoy it. And I'm excited. I can't wait.
The fact it's on Channel 5 as well is, you know, a cracking British fight on Channel 5. Watched by everyone.
It's going to be a classic, hopefully. I'm trying to find it, and it's going to be incredible. If you couldn't afford a ticket and you wanted to watch a good fight, what better way for free on Channel 5?
Yeah, definitely. Well, Chad, thanks ever so much for your time, mate.
No, thank you very much.
Really appreciate it. And I'll obviously send you anything over that we get live. Mate. Yeah, stop, man.
Oh, wicked. Thank you very much.
Thanks ever so much, mate. Keep training. Enjoy training.
Yeah, thank you, mate. Cheers.
Bye.
Bye.